Hello, can everybody hear me well? Hi, I'm Yanis Karaitis, and I'm a medical oncologist working in Southampton, as a lot of you might have already met me there. And thanks, Joe, for again inviting me and giving me a chance to talk about a topic that's quite close to my heart, actually, and that's clinical trials. It's a topic that some of you might have already heard from me in clinic, because taking part in clinical trials, unfortunately, is a sort of almost standard in ocular melanoma, because there's a lack of really good treatment options. But it's very rare to actually have the chance to properly delve in the clinical trials concept in more detail. I think it's something that it's not very well explained to the public at large, and it's something that we cannot really explain to people properly in clinic in just 15, 20 minutes. And I personally, my prime interest is actually in clinical trials. I run a special clinical trials clinic where we give people about 1 hour, an hour and a half to just run through the topics I'm going to try to go through here. So again, 5 minutes is not enough time to give this topic justice, but I'll try to at least give you an introduction to clinical trials and give you some pointers to where you can go and look for some more information that you might find interesting. So the aims of this session is, first of all, to actually define clinical trials. What is a clinical trial? Why do we need them? Who are they for? And what do they actually involve? What's the practical aspect? How do you find out about a trial? How do you to take part in a trial? So I started the talk, but like any of my talk, by disclosing that I have received honoraria at various times from different medical companies. For this particular talk, it makes no difference because the clinical trials is a generic topic. But what is worth, I've worked with BMS, Merck Serono, Delcath, Pierre Faber, and it's something that you, every time somebody reports on the results of a trial to you, you should ask, have they worked for that company? And now they have received compensation for it. So I think it's good practice to just declare in advance. So let's start with what the clinical trial is. Very helpfully, the WHO has provided a definition, which says any research study that prospectively assigns human participants or groups of humans to one or more health-related interventions to evaluate their effects on health outcomes. That's a very long-winded way for saying it's a coordinated effort that's scientifically driven to find out whether an intervention, a drug, a procedure is actually helpful for somebody and safe. Now, why is it? Why can we just try it? If you think that a drug works, why can you just give it to a patient and see if it makes them better? Why do you need a trial? Well, the reason you need a trial is that for thousands of years, this was the way we used to operate. We used to go to whatever the witch doctor used to be called at the time, whether it be an ancient priest or a sort of a faith healer or whatever it was, and they would provide something that was handed over by memory. And sometimes it would work, sometimes it wouldn't work, but by and large, if you look at the efficacy of medicines from the 18th century and before that, it's very limited. And yes, sometimes these things did work, and it's fair to say that some of the drugs we still use were traditional medical compounds, because eventually if you try a lot of compounds, something will work. It wasn't very effective, and a lot of people actually end up having more harm than good. Some examples is the use of mercury as a for its healing properties in the 1600s with catastrophic results. So, to give you an example why clinical trials are important, let's try for an example where not doing a clinical trial actually was detrimental. So, this is William Colley. He was a surgeon at the turn of the century in New York. And he worked in the hospital for the ruptured and crippled, which is a rather politically incorrect term, but back then it was accepted that that's what they would call these places. And he was a very good surgeon, and he was really deeply affected by the death of one of his young patients. So he went on to try to find out anything that was known that might have benefit a patient who had a very rapidly growing sarcoma. And back then, there was not many labs were not really developed. The knowledge of basic science wasn't really there. But what there was a big library with case reports of people who actually got better for some reason, despite the fact that one would expect them to have died if they had that horrible tumor. And he found out that there were about 38 case reports of cancer patients who developed a skin infection called erysipelas, which is a really nasty rash and very aggressive, where in 12 cases the tumor disappeared, and in the other 30 cases the tumor shrunk in patients having had the erysipelas. And he also noticed that there was a practice that surgeons did back in the 18th century, where they were operating on tumors. They used to leave the wound open and allow it to get infected because they thought that that would promote healing for the tumor bed for some reason. Now we know that what is all this did was indirect immunotherapy. By having the immune stimulation due to the infection, you got a response in some patients. Back then, this was people didn't even understand how the immune system worked at all. They had just about worked out it existed. So he went on to investigate this, and had his test subject was this unfortunate patient who had a very big lump in his neck. He tried initially to inject the bug that caused erysipelas in the skin, didn't do very much. Then he injected directly into the tumor, and he got a good response. The tumor shrunk, and the response lasted 8 years. So he was very excited. And as back then, there was no such thing as trials, and no such thing as ethics, there was no such thing as rules. He just started giving it to his patients without much thought. And some people benefited. 4 people actually got a response that had tumors that shrunk. 2 patients died. So he thought, this is not going to be work. So he had enough common sense to stop there and try to find a safer way of dealing with it. So he went on and discovered effectively what was a bit like a vaccine where you kill the bugs. He took the bacteria, he cultured them, then heat killed them and injected that mixture into the tumors. And his next trial patient did very well. And he carried on giving this for the best part of 3 decades. Unfortunately, although it was advertised privately in the newspapers, he never actually went on to test it formally. And was only properly reported by his daughter after he died, where she went back and tried to track down the records that were kept of the patients. And it looks like actually it was not too bad a treatment. I mean, 200 out of 1,200 patients treated is actually quite a good number that is only now we're starting to achieve that with immunotherapies that we have. However, because this was not properly documented, it was not properly recorded, it was not patented in any way, it went out of fashion. When he died, nobody used it properly. The method he was making it was not standardized, so people who tried to follow his example were not able to produce exactly the same results, so there was no reproducibility, so this went out of fashion. And as a result, it completely fell out of favor, it was forgotten, because people tried different types of immunotherapy since then with very little results, so they thought that this was a fluke or even a lie. Only now do we know that this was probably real, but because it was not tested, we had no way of proving it, so it went out the wayside. Now, what about the other side of things? What about things where we do a trial, where we think something is, we say, well, do you really do a trial? Actually, yes, you do, because something that you might think works actually doesn't. So this is a good example of why all these fads about nutritional supplements needs to be carefully assessed. So back in the 90s, there were several studies that saw that people who had vitamin deficiencies, particularly vitamin E, appear to have a higher risk of developing particular cancer types, most notably prostate cancer. The studies were not very big, but they included about several hundred patients. And there was also some lab results which suggested that if you added substances like selenium, vitamin E, they had antioxidant properties, so there was some theoretical reason why you'd expect that that might reduce cancer from occurring. So funding was accrued, and somebody went on and designed this huge study in the States where they recruited 35,000 men and gave them supplements, vitamin E and selenium supplements, and they did it properly. So they had 4 groups. One group that got both types of supplements, one group that got only one, and one group that got only placebos. And placebos were designed to taste exactly the same as the supplements, so that you knew that if there was an effect, it wasn't just a psychological effect, it was a real thing. And they followed patients for 10 years, and nothing happened. So they thought, or nothing significant happened. And they thought, well, surprise, surprise, another dietetic fad that didn't work out. Well, actually, it was a bit worse than that. When they looked into it, it turns out that people who had the vitamin E supplements actually had a higher incidence of prostate cancer, significantly higher, 17%. That's a lot. So not only was it not beneficial, it was actually actively detrimental. So just because something sounds a good idea, just because something sounds innocuous, doesn't mean that it's good for you. You need to try it. So unless you do a trial, you don't know. So this is why currently medicine is what we practice medicine based on evidence-based principles. Just relying on anecdotes, theoretical justifications, and even lab and animal studies is not sufficient. Unless you've tried something in humans, in a real life setting, don't believe it. It's very particularly difficult these days, in this day and age, with the internet, because you often hear about somebody tried X, Y, or Z, and they're better. What you don't hear is another 100,000 patients who tried X, Y, or Z and didn't get better, or even worse, got worse. You got no idea. You got lack of context. So it's very important that we do trials to try to actually find out if what we're trying to implement is actually beneficial and not harmful. So what are the questions, the fundamental questions that a clinical trial is designed to answer? Obviously, it depends on the trial specifically, but by and large, there's a few topics that are the core questions that we want to ask. First question, is the treatment safe? The prime motto of physicians is do no harm. So we want to know if what we're trying to give to a patient is safe for them. And not only that, but nothing is safe. Water can cause side effects if you drink enough of it. Salt causes side effects. Oxygen can damage your lungs if you drink enough high concentration. So we know that whatever we try will cause some side effects given to enough people over enough time. But what we want to know is what side effects it causes, how frequently, how severe they are, and ultimately, are they worth the benefit that the patient might derive from it? So you do need to know this. Second question, which actually is what most people think first when thinking about a trial, is does the treatment actually work? Does it do what it says on the tin? And for us, it's more important not just does it work in general, is how well it works and for whom. Because as we all know, treatments that work very well in one type of cancer might not work at all in some types of cancer. In the worst case scenario, they make people worse. So the BRAF inhibitors, for example, that are used in skin melanoma, if we use them as they are in bowel cancer with the same mutation, they actually make people worse because there's a different genetic environment there, a different mutational environment. And finally, and this is a question for some specific trials, the late phase trials, is what you want to know is, fine, you've got a treatment, it's safe enough, it works for some people. Is it better than existing treatments? Is it worth it? If you've got two treatments to choose for, which one should you go for? Which one should you go for first? So these are all key questions that you want to ask in the trial. So let's go about how do trials try to address these questions. First of all, safety. The most important thing is to record all the side effects that occur during a trial accurately and reproducibly. By that I mean that if you have a trial run in Japan, in Saudi Arabia, in Brazil, you need to be able to record the side effects in a way that is every person, wherever they are, they can understand that this patient had a rush. A rush on its own doesn't mean anything. What type of a rush was it? Where was it? How extensive was it? You need to be able to codify it in a way that you can record it and compare. And the way this is done these days is people have developed this tool, which is called the Common Terminology Criteria for Adverse Events. It's a very long-winded word for a big, thick booklet that lists every possible complication you can imagine. I mean a lot of things that you would not imagine. And it tries to give a grading to each one of them, which by and large goes like this. Grade 0 means no side effect. Grade 1 means that, yes, it's something that we noticed, but it's not really affecting the patient's quality of life, and you don't really need to do anything about it other than watching, make sure it doesn't get worse. Grade 2 means actually that is starting to have an effect on the patient's quality of life, and you probably do need to do something about it, whether it's stop the drug you're giving, whether it's given another medication, you do something, you cannot just ignore it. Grade 3 is things are getting serious here. Patient is probably not feeling very well, and what you need to do something serious. So patient needs to come to hospital to have treatment. Grade 4, life-threatening complications, that's serious stuff. That's the brain bleeds, blood clots, collapses, heart attacks, that type of thing. These are things that are potentially life-threatening and almost certainly would require hospital stay. This is what you don't want to see in your trials. Grade 5 is where things go really wrong. And that's you definitely don't want to see that. So you want to record not just the severity, but also how many times these things occur, how frequently do they occur early, do they occur late. And the idea is that if you collect this information for the early studies, then when a patient comes for a later study or later patient in the same study, you're going to tell them, well, we may not know all the possible side effects, but at least we know that this has happened. So people know what to expect, and also the doctors know what to expect as well. If you know that a month on the line people will develop a rush, but it will go away without needing to do anything, you're going to be less panicky than if you know that in 3 weeks' time they'll develop a rush, and if you don't do something about it, their hair will fall out or something like that. So it's important. So, next thing, efficacy. Does a treatment work? Now, that obviously depends on the type of tumor you're dealing with, but because this is an ocular melanoma conference, we'll talk about cancer-related efficacy. And there's three key things that you're looking for when you look at the trial reporting outcomes. The first is response rates. Response means, has the tumor shrunk? And are there any new tumors? Those are the two things that you're looking for. Progression-free survival. How long does this treatment going to be effective to keep the disease from progressing, from getting worse? And finally, this is the key one, overall survival. How long do people live having had this treatment? Which is the key question we want to answer, really. And these three things used to be all related, but now with our new treatments, immunotherapies in particular, they're not necessarily linked. We find that people who might not get big response rates, but actually may find that survival is positively affected. So you need to look at all three. One on its own is not sufficient. And I'll go in a bit more into that in a second. So response to treatment. Typically, we have these four wordings for the types of response you see. Best case scenario, complete response. Tumor disappears. No matter what test you do, you cannot detect it. You can do PET scans, you can do whatever, it's all clear. That's what we would like to see. Partial response, that's a significant shrinkage in the size of tumors by more than 30% objectively. So what we do is that we have to have tumors that we can measure and compare the measurements between different scans. Once we reach that magical number of 30% shrinkage, we're in there. Then we've got stable disease. That means that effectively, while there might be some change in size, it's less than 30% benefit or less than 20% worse. And that's what we call stable disease. It's a bit of an iffy definition, and in the old days before immunotherapy, it generally wasn't considered to be a real response, because most of the older treatments, you either shrunk the tumor or if you didn't, it wasn't actually going to work and things would go worse very quickly. With immunotherapy, it has changed a bit, and you have a lot of people where actually this stable disease is not a bad outcome to have, as long as it's maintained. And then, of course, progressive disease is the worst scenario where things just get bigger and bigger or you get new lumps appearing. And this is an example of how you could measure it. This is the infamous waterfall plots. And they're called like that because they look like a waterfall, supposedly. And you can see that on this axis, you measure the percentage change in the size of a tumor from the baseline. So if there's no change, they're there. If it gets smaller, it shrinks. Goes down here, and you can see it goes all the way down to minus 100, which is disappearance. And if it gets bigger, it goes bigger by whatever percentage. And anything that's between those two cutoffs, 30% for response and 20% for progression is stable disease. Anything which is here, as you can see, is green, is partial response. And you can see this green, deep green, which are the complete response. Now, if you ask why these little guys here are not complete responders, it's probably because they've had some small lumps that were never measurable, but have not disappeared completely. So you cannot call them complete responders, or in all likelihood they are. Conversely, you have people where, although you cannot measure things, new lumps appearing. So you have to classify them as disease progression. And if you look at a formalized report of a trial, you'll almost certainly find a table which lists how many people responded and what type of response they had. So this. Any trials that reports outcomes should have this list. If they don't have that outcomes, then the trial is really not doing things properly. Now, more importantly, what about the what we call overall and progression-free survival? These are numbers that are often branded about, and these numbers actually are the numbers that traditionally we were asked at our clinical consultation to say by patients, doctor, how much time have I got? What we used to refer to that was the overall median survival. And in the old days, that was a sort of meaningful number because of the way it was calculated. And normally, you sort of calculate this number from the time, a given time point, which is normally the time of diagnosis or the time of first treatment. And you have a time point where this is progressing or a patient passed away. And the way you try to calculate this number is a bit more complicated than you would have thought. So you draw these diagrams, which are called Kaplan-Meier curves. And on this axis, you see how many people are alive at a given point in time, and as a percentage. So you can see at the beginning, 10.0, everybody's alive, 100%. And the longer you go down the line, some people sadly are no longer with us. But what you can see is that for some treatments, like chemotherapy, the curve is quite low down. So you can see that quite quickly about 50% of people are still there. And you can see that this is the number that you call the overall survival, the median overall survival. But this number is meaningless when you ask for, say, a treatment that works so well that it keeps more than 50% of people alive, that number. And this can be because the treatment is very effective, or it can be because whoever is reporting the trial hasn't followed the people for long enough. So you end up with a meaningless comment, median overall survival not reached, which you might often see with the new drugs especially. But what you can still do is, if you go and look at the raw data, you can still see how well people are doing, and particularly if you got the standard of care plotted at the same time, you can see clearly that people are doing much, much better on the new treatment than the old one. And there are good statistical ways you can compare the two, and you can see whether this is something that's a meaningful difference or just a statistical fluke. Progression-free survival works in exactly the same way. It just tells you at any given point in time how many people the disease is still under control. But what you will notice that the graphs often have a much steeper drop. And that's an artifact. That's an artifact of the fact that for the first couple of months, people don't have scans. So you don't really know if they're getting better or worse. And suddenly around 2-3 months, they've got a mandated scan, and suddenly you have to readjust. So in reality, the care probably continues here as well, but this is the point where things move around. But what's interesting, particularly in this case, is that the two things don't necessarily match the depth of the curve. You can see that people progress here at a different rate than they drop off on this curve. So you can have a drug that people respond very well immediately, but actually the response is not maintained, and then it tails off. And that drug might not be very effective. Or you can have a drug where you have a very poor response rate, but actually people live longer because it has a very long tail of action. So you actually need all the information to be able to tell whether a drug or intervention is actually worthwhile or not. You need the response rate, which is most important in interventions that are acute, emergency. If you've got somebody who's got a tumor that's rapidly growing and threatening a vital organ, you want a treatment that's going to work quickly. You cannot afford to give a treatment that works over many months or years even. On the other hand, if you've got somebody who's got a very slow-growing tumor, what you really want is this. You want to give them the treatment that gives them the best option of long-term benefit. So when you evaluate different treatments, you need all these numbers. So just looking at a snapshot of a report from an early trial saying we've got very high response rates, but we've only followed the patients for 3 months, that's meaningless. It's encouraging, but until you get longer follow-up, you can't really say how useful that treatment is going to be or not. You need all the information. So, with that in mind, let's go into specific trials. What type of trials are there? Well, we've got early phase trials and late phase trials, and they're slightly different beasts. The early phase trials are split to phase one and phase two, and phase one are the really, really beginning. This is an intervention that has not been tried before in humans at all, whether it's a new drug or a combination of drugs that hasn't been tried before, or a drug given in a dose or setting that has never been tried before in humans. And the main question you're trying to ask is it safe to give this drug, full stop? Once you answer that question, then you can move to the phase two trials, which is basically the main question you ask is, does it actually do anything useful? And once you've answered that question positively, then you go to phase three trial, which is much bigger, and you ask, well, it's safe, it does something useful, is it better than what that's already out there? So let's dig into this a bit more. These trials take a long time to come through. Often, the compounds can be in development for many, many years or decades even before they ever see the face of the clinic. Phase one trials generally don't take too long to run. It might take long to set up, but once you've got them up and running, because you only recruit something between 10 and 30 patients, generally, you should be able to finish them in a year or a year and a half. Phase two trials, a bit longer, because you want to actually find if something's working and follow people up to see how well it's working. So generally, these things take several years. Phase three trials, now you're looking into hundreds of patients, ideally. And that can take many years, to do. In some types of diseases which are which recruitment is very slow, this can take decades even. And you may hear about phase 4 trials. Although they're called trials, not really trials. This is basically after the drug has been approved, continuing monitoring to make sure that all the outcomes that you've seen in the trials actually hold true in the real world. So going back to the trials, different trials specifically. So phase 1 trials, what are we really asking there? They're designed to ask, is it safe to give these patients to humans full stop? And the reason you ask it, because we want to know that before you start opening the trial to more people. Putting 10 patients at risk is one thing. Putting 100 patients at risk is a different thing. So before you open a big trial and put lots of people at risk, you want to actually know how safe it is. And the second question you want to ask, it's very important, what dose can we give? Because could be that you've got a drug that's perfectly safe at a low dose, but the moment you got the dose that you really would need to have a benefit, you get really bad side effects. And many promising compounds are abandoned at this stage because they may work very well in models, they may work very well in animals, but if you cannot give it safely to a human, it's no good. Secondary questions that we're asking, but we may not necessarily get answered at this point, is who's more likely to benefit and what are the best doses to use? Because the highest dose is not necessarily the best dose. It could be that a medium dose is better, like you find with some vitamins, for example. And traditionally, selection criteria for taking part in this study is quite lax. Basically, you need to be fit and you need to have no direct contraindications to the compound that you're trying to use, pretty much. Recent years, this has changed a bit. And now the compounds are a lot more targeted. So we try to recruit patients who have, at least we would expect, to have a reasonable chance of benefit based on the mechanism of action of the compound we're using. But it's still a lot more lax the criteria than any of the other trials. A few practical issues regarding these trials. Because these are quite intense trials, patients are monitored very, very closely with lots of blood tests, many visits, sometimes they have to have overnight stays, and the clinicians who do in these centers need to be properly trained because unlike giving a regular drug, you need to be prepared for the unexpected here. You need to be prepared for any type of side effect affecting any type of organ. Sometimes this can be very sudden. So you need to have a very experienced team. So only a few centers can actually are properly equipped to run these types of trials. The second thing to remember is that because you're trying to figure out the right dose, patients are recruited stepwise. The trial generally does not just open and everybody can go on it. You first recruit a small number of patients, typically anything between 1 and 3. You give a certain dose. You wait and see how safe it is. After a certain fixed interval has passed and you're happy and convinced that that dose is safe enough, then you move and you recruit 3 more patients. And that goes on and on until you reach the dose that either you're happy with, that you don't need to go any further because it's got the effect that you would expect, or you reach a dose that's no longer tolerated, it's too toxic. And that can often mean that people have to wait a long time to take part in the study. And this is a typical example, as I said. You start off, you enroll 3 patients. First patient gets treated. You wait for a week. No immediate side effects. You give the treatment to 2 more patients at the same dose. No side effects, fine. You move on to the next dose. 1 patient out of the 3 gets a side effect, you recruit more patients in the same dose. No other gets side effects, you move on to the next dose. More side effects occur, that's it. You've got the dose. That's the maximum tolerated dose. And you go back. And obviously there's different ways you can tweak this scheme. You can because the biggest problem with this is that for some compounds, you may start at a very, very low dose to make sure it's safe. And while that's scientifically the best way to do it and the safest way to do it, from a patient's point of view, that means that you may well be getting a very low dose that is doing nothing useful. So some compounds try to limit the number of patients that are receiving the lowest doses. Some trials now are running what we call intra-patient dose escalation, where we are allowed to put the patient back in at a higher dose level down the line once it's happy that's working. But it's a very difficult thing, and it's a very challenging thing to explain to people. So these trials are available to a few people only, because by default, you only recruit very small numbers of patients. The waiting lists are very common, as I said, because you have to wait until the slot becomes available to be treated. Many patients will end up receiving low and high doses. So when you take part in an early phase trial, that's a pure phase one, actually the chances are you will end up getting either a toxic dose or an insufficiently high dose. So the chance of benefit is not that high. And of course, the biggest thing is that you are effectively a human guinea pig at that point, because you don't know what the side effects are, you don't know how likely it is to work, and so on and so forth. So it's very tricky. But on the other hand, all the drugs we've got now started at this point, and clearly people benefited at that point, otherwise the drugs wouldn't have moved on. So it's a challenging thing. Phase two trials are the next step up. So at that point, at least you know that by and large, the intervention you're trying to do to give is safe. You know the common side effects, and you can explain to patients, people can expect them. What you might not necessarily know is whether it actually works. You hopefully would have seen some inkling that it's working from the earlier, for the phase one study, but unless it was properly targeted in the group of patients with a tumor that you have, the findings might not necessarily translate to a different tumor type. A classic example is skin melanoma and ocular melanoma. Immunotherapies work very well in skin melanoma. Ocular melanoma, well, they can definitely work, but they don't work anywhere near as well. And that's something that you wouldn't know until you've done the trial. The other question you want to ask is, obviously, giving the treatment now to more patients. As you can imagine, if you only give the treatment to about 20, 30 patients in a phase one trial, any side effect that's uncommon, anything that's less than 1 in 20, say, you wouldn't necessarily observe that. So you really want to find out, what are the uncommon side effects? Are there any serious uncommon side effects? A classic example with immunotherapies would be the development of heart inflammation and brain inflammation. They're very uncommon. If you just did the phase one trial, you wouldn't have known that is a risk. But it is a risk. And you only knew because you did a bigger trial. A secondary question, which is very important, is try to focus on who benefits from this particular intervention. This is something that we've seen more and more, in that you don't want to give a drug potentially toxic to a group of patients that are not going to benefit ultimately from it. If you can find a marker somehow, whether it's a genetic marker or something else, that this group is more likely to benefit, you want to use it and try to offer it to in a sort of personalized way. It was like, this is the holy grail of personal medicine, that anybody is only going to get a drug that they know is going to be effective for them. As I mentioned, these studies recruit a lot more people, so it's a lot easier to get into, and usually more sites offer this type of drugs. However, the flip side is that the criteria that allow you to take part in the study are more restrictive. They may say that you're not allowed to have heart disease, they may not allowed to have asthma, you may not be allowed to be on particular medications. So you may fall foul of that. And sometimes these days, this can be slightly more complex trials where you don't just check one intervention, but you have multiple interventions, maybe different doses of the same drug, maybe same dose but a different interval. So one is having injection every 2 weeks, one group every 4 weeks. So what are the issues there? Well, this again is that there's very much significant uncertainty regarding how likelihood this is going to be beneficial. Side effects, especially uncommon and rare ones, especially with completely new compounds that have not been tried before. And obviously the optimal dosing, which is what the trial is trying to establish in the first place. Supposing a compound or intervention gets through the phase two hurdle, and you've got a trial that shows that actually this is safe enough, and this is not just safe enough, but actually a significant number of patients benefit from this, then you actually want to go and see whether this actually is useful in reality, in the real setting. How does it compare with existing treatments? I mean, it's great if you have a treatment that treats 1 in 100 people with a particular condition, but if you've got a standard treatment that's cheaper, safer, and treats half of your patients, then actually you wouldn't keep that other than as a last resort. The issues with these studies is that they're often very large, and they often have groups that contain this definitions: placebos, standard of care, investigator choice. And that's something that is sometimes misunderstood. So placebo, what is a placebo? Placebo is really lack of an intervention. It's basically you're using it where you're trying to compare intervention against just observing and just managing the symptoms. Why would you do that? Well, you do that if you've got a situation where there's no known effective treatment at all and where the standard of care would be to do nothing. And why do you do that? Why do you just don't give the treatment and take the risk? Because sometimes, as I showed, doing nothing might be better than doing something that causes harm. And especially if you've got an intervention where the benefit is slightly borderline, you really want to check that you're doing no harm with it. This becomes more difficult to justify if you've got a situation where there's a very clear sign of effectiveness on the phase 2 study. There, that you cannot really run that anymore, and then you may have to do some more complicated designs to justify it. Standard of care is slightly easier to understand. It's basically whatever is used currently. So for example, if you had melanoma, for example, immunotherapy standard of care. So a new compound would need to be compared with standard immunotherapy to see if it's better or worse. Investigator's choice is a tricky one, and that's normally used when you've got a trial that's run in multiple countries where the standard of care is not accepted, or where the same treatment is not available in different countries where the trial is run. So say, for example, not in melanoma, but say you've got a treatment where one type of chemotherapy is used in France, one in the UK, and one in the States, and there's no agreement as to which one is the better. So what you say then, fine, I've got my new treatment. This is offered to everybody as a one arm, and the other arms gets whatever the doctor would have normally offered them if this trial wasn't available. And it's still meaningful because it then compares what would have happened if the new treatment wasn't available. And you do need the comparator arm. And this is a difficult thing. Sometimes people feel hard done by where they're randomized to one of these arms. But actually, they're essential because you don't know if you're better off or not. It could be that you're much better off with standard of care. The number of trials, phase 3 trials that have failed is actually quite considerable. Even in the most recent counting, about 40% of phase 3 trials fail to show efficacy, and a fair few have actually shown that people on the new treatments are worse off. So these are important. So, as I mentioned, there's a lot of risks and uncertainties for taking part in a trial, which with any of these trials, there's no guarantee of efficacy. The phase 3 trials, at least you have a hint that something is more likely to work, but with the early phase trial, there may be an indication it's worked. There may be that some people who fed it at the earlier studies have benefited. So if you've got nothing else to try, then yes, by all means, there's something beneficial there. But you need to understand that we don't know what this drug does or how effective it's going to be. So who are the best candidates for trials? Whoever takes part in a trial needs to understand that first and foremost, the benefit is not necessarily to them. The benefit is for the patients that come after them, for the society at large. Because whether the trial works or not, the information that will be gained will drive future research and the future treatments. Of course, the hope is that they will benefit, but that's by no means guaranteed. For the early phase trials, I think that this should really be targeting patients who are either completely run out of any standard choices or are unhappy with available options. So it could be, for example, that the available option is some really debilitating chemotherapy, and the patient's got a very strong view against it. In that case, that might be appropriate to consider an early phase trial. But certainly, I wouldn't consider it to people who've got potentially curable treatment options. Late phase trials are generally more inclusive, and as long as the patients understand what they're getting into, I think it's fair game. If they're allowed by the criteria to take part, they can take part. But they need to really have a frank discussion with their clinicians as to what their alternatives are as standard of care. And this gets us to the ethics. Clinical trials started off badly in the middle of the century because they were initially done in a completely unethical way. Everybody knows the horrors from the Nuremberg trial for the Nazi scientists that tried all sorts of things on poor, unwilling subjects. And both the United States and the UK are not immune to that, but as a lot of horrific experiments were carried out and patients were not informed that they were taking part in trials, whether it's exposure to syphilis, whether it's exposure to radioactive waste, and so on and so forth. So after several scandals became apparent, all the nations got together and published the Declaration of Helsinki, which is a statement of ethical principles for medical research involving human subjects, which states a fair few what you'd have thought is common sense principles, but actually up to that point they weren't, which is that we have to respect individuals' large self-determination, which effectively means that you're allowed to decide what you want to do with your body at any point in time. You can agree to take part in a trial, and you can withdraw that agreement at any point. You need to make informed decisions, so you need to have the information, the right information, to make those decisions. And the subject, the welfare of a patient, always takes precedence over the interest of society. So just before, because it would be nice for society to know if this drug causes a side effect, you're not allowed to just continuing giving this drug to see how much you can tolerate. If the patient is suffering, you should stop straight away. If the patient is coming to harm, you should stop. And the duty to the patient takes precedence of any duties to a drug company, the state, and so on and so forth. So there's now formalized guidelines as to how these principles have to be applied. In the UK, we call this good clinical practice, and all members of clinical trials teams are obliged to have been fully trained and follow those principles throughout. And the concept of obtaining and maintaining informed consent is essential. If you are asked to take part in a trial, it's essential that you understand what consent means. And really, it means that you understand what you're getting into. You got all the information that you need to make that decision, and you're aware that it's fully voluntary. You're not given monetary inducement. You're not given a threat that you'd not be treated. And you understand that if at any point you want to walk out of the trial, you can walk out. You don't need to give a reason. You change your mind. Whatever reason. You had enough. Doesn't need to be a reason. Signing just says that you're happy at that point in time to take part in the trial. You can always walk back. You might need to read the small print regarding the right of the trials team to use any sample or information they collect from you. Because some trials will ask you for permission to do genetic testing, to use tissues, and so on and so forth. In most cases, when you sign the consent form, there's particular lines that say what you agree to. And all these extra things are usually optional. So actually, do take the time to read through that. Now, the problem with all this information is that usually it's a lot of information, and unfortunately the ethics committees in their wisdom ask for more and more information to be given. So now when you take part in a trial, you typically be given a very, very thick booklet listing everything possible that anybody has thought that might be relevant to somebody in the trial. Sometimes they can be useful. For some people they are useful. For many people they're less useful because you get lost in there. So there's now supposed to be summaries given out where you can actually read brief summary of what the trial is about, what's the main risks and side effects. And then you can go and read the whole thing at your own time. Whatever happens, you should always be given time to think about taking part of the trial. It should be given as much time as needed. Typically, we say 24 hours. For this type of trials, like often quite complex, I would say a lot more. They should state exactly what rationale is, what's the evidence that's driving this trial. They should explain what the trial involves in practical terms. How many times do you have to come to the clinic? How many times do you have to come to hospital? How many blood tests? What do you do if something goes wrong? Who do you contact? What are the known risks? What are the potential, at least predictable risks? What are the alternatives if you don't take part in the trial? And obviously, any financial interest. So is this run by a company? Is this done by an academic that has got set up their own company? You need to have the time, and if you don't feel you've had enough time, you're always allowed to ask for more time to think about it. And as I said, consent must be voluntary. As I said, there's this thing that's very important to remember. Just agreeing to take part in a trial doesn't mean that you will take part in the trial. There's this process called screening, which is very important, particularly in early phase trials, to make sure that it's safe for patients to take part in the trial. This normally involves a number of tests, could be blood tests, could be scans, could be heart recordings. And only once all these tests are complete, that's when the green light is given and the patient can actually start taking part in the trial. And because these tests can actually be sometimes very, very stringent, not everybody is able to take part in the trial. And they should warn you up front if that's the case. So if, for example, a trial is only offered in those who have a particular blood type, like, for example, the IMCGP trials, they should say that you only got a 50-50 chance of having that particular blood type if the result is not known. Trial discontinuation. It's very important for trials to specify at what point you stop taking part in the trial. This could be a natural thing, so it could be that a trial is given for 4 doses and that's it. no more is envisaged, whether it's worked or not. It could be that treatment stops if it stops working, or it could be that treatment has to be stopped if there's a side effect, a particular type of effect is met. Treatment can always be stopped, as I said, if the patient decides that it's not right for them, for whatever reason, whether it's side effects or not. It could be that the side effects are acceptable from the trial's point of view, but are unacceptable for the patient. And of course, the trial can be stopped from the company or the institution that's running the trial if enough information is collected from other subjects to say that actually either this definitely isn't working or actually this is harmful, whether it's because of side effects or because it's making the disease grow faster or whatever. So that's something that this people need to be clear about. So, in summary, I went through sort of this roller coaster of a very sort of brief overview of what clinical trials are about and what the sort of principles are behind the design. I think it's pretty clear that they're essential for evidence-based medicine and to drive safe clinical practice. The decision to take part in a trial is a very personal one. It depends on your circumstances. It depends on your acceptance of risk. It depends on what you expect from quality of life. It may be that you're feeling well, you've got no symptoms from your disease. In ocular melanoma, it's very common that people who've got lots of small liver mets actually feel fine. And they may feel fine for many months or years even. Do you want to take part in a trial that involves very invasive procedures that will make you have to go to hospital once a week for however many months? It's a question that you need. It's a very personal one. And it's not one that is for the doctors to decide. We are there to offer you the information, what's available, what it involves, and then you'll have to decide yourself whether you think that that's the right thing for you. Going to a trial, you should not expect a guaranteed outcome. If we knew that a particular treatment works, we wouldn't be doing a trial for it. And any doctor who says you otherwise is setting things up for you. Yes, we hope that it will be beneficial. Yes, we would really like it to be beneficial. But if we knew it definitely was beneficial, we would be testing it in a trial. We would just be offering it to patients. And also remember that don't get your hopes too high up if a trial's got particularly stringent screening criteria, because sometimes you might fail screening, and you see that time and again, and it's very disappointing, and we need to be clear to anybody who takes part in the trial that there's still hurdles before you can actually go on. And always remember that the one thing that group that will benefit from your participation in the trial is future generations and future patients. So even if the trial itself fails completely to show a benefit, the information that we'll get from the trials will drive future treatments and will prevent people from having this treatment unnecessarily. And that's really the key reason for taking part in the trial beyond anything else. Thank you very much for your attention. Any questions?
Thank you, Yanis. You'll see in a moment, we've actually got quite a few questions for you have been lining up throughout your talk.
Okay, let's see if I can...
So you can tackle the ones that you're happy to do so now, and then maybe come back to the others, if that's okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so stage 1, 2, 3, and 4, against ocular melanoma. So that's an unrelated question to this, but basically all the stages that matter for ocular melanoma really are stage 4 or not stage 4. Stage 4 is disease that has spread beyond the eye. And that's what matters, because everything else pretty much always is stage 1, because it's almost always caught at the point where it's simple at the base of the eye. It's very rare that you get a stage 3. I've yet to see one, and I've been doing this for a long time. Stage 3 really means that it's spread to one of the lymph nodes. And it's almost always spread elsewhere if it's spread to a lymph node. So you never see stage 3. You see stage 4 or stage 1 or 2. Melanoma. Good question. So that will depend on the person you visit and the clinician. The evidence base is really limited right now for ocular melanoma. Clearly, patients have benefited. I've seen people responding to ipilimumab. I've seen people responding to pembrolizumab. I've seen people responding to both. The published data shows that the response rates to a single agent are quite low, definitely in patients who've got uncontrolled liver disease. The response rates for combination is probably hovering around the 15-20%, so it's worth trying if somebody's fit, But if not, then maybe trying the single agents on their own. And to be honest, if it's a clinical trial available, I'd normally divert people to a clinical trial because the evidence is so poor right now for the standard of care that I don't think it makes a huge difference. What happens if you enter the trial which is already started? That's very simple. You ask to take part in it. It's only you cannot take part in a trial that's closed to recruitment. A trial in setup is a different kettle of fish, and that you should just not think very much about it because there's many trials in setup that never actually start. So only look for trials that are actually open and recruiting. And if you look at the various database of trials, they should say open to recruitment. I think I mentioned that before, what should I go in the trial? Trials not for everybody, and we're given a... So, the point of a trial which involves a placebo means that there is no accepted treatment that works in that particular setting. So, the standard of care would be observation. So, you don't know if by going, if having a treatment, you're actually doing yourself a favor. It might be that by having the treatment, you're just giving yourself side effects and doing the cancer no, makes the cancer getting no benefit in terms of the cancer. Instead, actually, there have been cases where the treatment has made the cancer worse. And actually, in those cases, the people who had placebo did better. That's why it's important to have these trials. Now, it's difficult to do these trials if there's very strong evidence of the treatment being effective. And that's why you don't see this type of trials. That's why you've seen drugs being sort of approved for treatment on the basis of very strong phase 1 and 2 data. But the data then need to be really strong, and there need to be no existing treatments at work in that context. So I think somebody asked how much money does it cost to run a trial? Millions. Millions and millions. Even the most basic of phase 1 trials cost many, many millions to run. So the phase 3 trials easily can run into billions. Students being used to stays as very young patients. I'm not convinced about the evidence of that. Once the evidence is there, then yes, but I think that the evidence of that being particularly effective is not really there. Placebo we mentioned it. I think I answered the first question already. I'm not sure I understand the question. So, square up with evidential evidence-based medicine. Not Vienna. Well, I think that the do nothing prognosis might be good night Vienna. Now, I think I see the point. I think it's the same thing. The do nothing sometimes can be better than doing something that causes problems. If you see the side effects of, if you're somebody who's had really nasty side effects from combination immunotherapy, who are bedridden with swollen joints, having diarrhea, having to go to the toilet 20 times a day, sort of feeling rotten and with painful limbs, and they don't get any benefit, you would argue that actually they would have been better off staying at home and not doing anything. Now, as it happens, for that particular treatment, they also give them a decent chance of benefit as well. You didn't know you were going to get it, but you don't know that up front if you don't do the trial. And that's why you do need the trials to see whether actually you're better off having it. I personally would say that that's why I say it's a personal choice as to whether you want to take part in the trial or not. If it's something that you're not happy with conceptually, then that trial is not for you. Can screening influence actual trials? Yeah, I mean, screening doesn't influence the outcome of trials per se. Screening allows you to have trials that are reproducible. You want to make sure that the group of people that take part in the trial are as homogeneous as possible, so that if somebody's getting a side effect, you know it's a drug causing it. It could be, for example, that a particular compound is suspected of causing heart complications. Now, if you were to include people with heart disease in the trial, then you wouldn't know whether if something goes wrong, it went wrong because the heart disease played up anyway or because the drug caused it. And you've got no way of knowing if the side effects would occur anyway if the patient didn't have heart disease. So what you'll do at the early phase, there's 3, would be to not offer people with heart disease that particular drug, But then that's when you would do the stage 4 trial. Once the drug is approved for everybody, then you would monitor people who want to use it who have got heart disease to see, well, is it safe to do? Which is what we're doing with immunotherapies right now. All the trials excluded people with pre-existing autoimmune conditions. So now what we're doing now is that they're trying to collect information about patients who give immunotherapies who have autoimmune conditions and see what happens. Sorry. One second. Back even extensive. Yeah. Yeah, that's a big problem. I alluded to this. Unfortunately, the powers that be have insisted on more and more and more information being included in the information pack. And many trials now have got information packs that run around to 40, 50 pages, and they're really thick. And I personally find them really unhelpful. And we're desperately trying to persuade ethics committees to cut down on the requirements. I think it's important that that information is accessible, that it's there for the patients, because there will always be people who want to get that particular bit of information there. But I think what we really need is a more concise sort of 4 or 5 page document that says, this is why we're doing a trial, these are the common or expected risks, and a little sort of list of timelines of what to expect and when to expect. And then people can read that first, and then they can go and read the whole thing. In practice, my experience is that I really have to struggle to persuade people to read that information leaflet. I think it's important because very often there's little sort of small print information that matters. So, for example, in some trials, it may say that we will collect your blood for genetic testing. If we find a genetic abnormality, we may contact you, if you so wish. And you need to read that because then you need to tick that box on the back. Because if you don't, you may get an unwelcome report that actually you've got this genetic problem in you that you probably didn't want to know about and may have implications for you, your family, insurance, and so on and so forth. Or conversely, you may actually want to know about and you may need to tick the box in the other way. But these are the things that really are the things that should be flagged up. In terms of why is this information not publicly available, I'm not sure why. It's really, in my view, if a trial is available to the public, that should be a common thing that anybody could just go on and click and download from the internet. But so a lot of these trials are run commercially, and as a result, there's a lot of confidentiality issues involved in there. I think it's an evolving field, and now with the advent of the internet, I think this is still living in the days where everything was done on paper.
One final question. My question is actually on drug approval. And mm-hmm. before I ask it, I have to give you a comparison. Mm-hmm. If you look at the situation with Boeing aircraft, which I get FAA approval, has been outsourced to Boeing, so it's self-approval. Now, I just wonder, with the drug FDA and the British equivalent, do they use the test data or do they perform their own test data?
Oh, this is a very important question. They have to use the test data provided by the company purely because it's impossible. The cost would be exorbitant. There's no way that the MHRA or any regulator could repeat those test data. But, and this is a big but, they are allowed and they do monitor the conduct of trials. So when you do a phase one trial, you have a monitor that's going to come in every other week and check the records of all the patients and check all the results and make sure that all the things that you're documenting in the database actually matches what's in the source data. They'll check that everybody who takes part in the trial, as in research personnel, is trained. They'll check that the right, say the drug is to be kept at minus 80 degrees in the fridge, that it is kept at minus 80 degrees in the fridge. So all these things are monitored by the regulator, and it's their responsibility to check that. So what they are doing is they're monitoring the conduct of the trials, but they have to take the results of the trials at face value.
Yeah, sorry, just to make clear that both regulators, FDA and EMA, they do provide scientific advice that's scientifically binding, that is to say, in the design of the studies, so they do have some control over the design before they start.
I mean, obviously, the protocol has to be approved both by the MHRA, EMA, and by the Ethics Committee. So it's not that the company comes up with a design out of their head and then runs with it. It has to be and in most places, it has to be approved by the local committee as well in the hospitals where it's run.
So the NICE comes
afterwards? The NICE is very at the very end. NICE is irrelevant. The drug might be available privately. NICE only says that this should be funded by NHS money. It doesn't say whether the drug is effective or not. All it says is whether the value to the NHS is there. It could be that you've got a drug that cures everybody, but if it costs $1 billion a pop, the NHS can't afford it.
Thank you for answering all those questions. I appreciate your time. Thank you.